Gotta have my mic on if we're gonna do anything today. How is everybody doing? How's everybody doing? I'm having a pretty good day. Having a pretty good day. How about the rest of you guys? I can't wait forever. Unfortunately, there's still like 15 seconds delay, even though I've got the delay reducer checkbox marked thingy. But, yeah. Anyway, yeah, having a good week. My allergies are doing a lot better, mainly because it has been pouring rain for the last 2 days. All right. So, anyway, this was a poll that we put up last week about what we should do this week. And there were supposed to be two parts to it. We had first to find out whether we wanted to continue the desperation hack or not, and then otherwise what else we should do. So we only had one vote on the whether or not we should continue the desperation hack, and it was for yes, continue it, and we could do some ability edits. And had a couple people go for picking a new topic to start on rather than desperations. Hey, Dirge. Hey, Locke. Hey, Dre. Awesome. Awesome. Good to see you guys are doing well today. And had a bunch of people say I should work on Children of Hector, which I will definitely get around to. Hey, Geen Attack made it. All right. And then one for other, which I think was me, actually, because I just wanted to not have to click on show results every time. So I just clicked other and then voted. So I'm not going to jump right into Children of Hector. I think I will actually go and do a little bit more on the desperation hack, at least touch on it. I can kill two birds with one stone here, because there was a suggestion to go over some of the logic and some of the code changes I did for L'Oreal's ability. And I actually pulled that up. And so what I can do is I can actually touch on this, which should hopefully man, I am drawing a blank today. Wow, got a few people I don't recognize on tonight. Man, that bright green, though. How do I pronounce that? Is that just supposed to be, like, 11 Kaiden? Like, the Roman numeral? Like, XI? Or is it supposed to be, like, Zai Kaiden? Zai Kaiden Masters. It makes me think that it's a thing. If you can be a master of it, it makes me think that it's a thing. So what is that? What is that? Please tell me. Dre, are you Sam? Are you Sam Yi? I think you must be. If you were FFRKing. Or are you the FFR King? Are you the Record King? Ah, gotcha. IRC chat. Do those still exist? I guess chat boxes are still basically the same thing as, like, old chat rooms. Okay. Yeah, well, I play FFRK also, then. Oh, wait a second. Do I know you? Are you on, Sorry, Dre, I'm get a little bit mixed up when I jump from, thing to thing. I have a really bad problem with segregating things in my brain, like, totally. So if I have a bad problem with, like, planning multiple things for one day in the same time slot, because I separate stuff in my head so easily. So I've got, like, the people that I talk to about Final Fantasy Record Keeper, and I've got the people I talk to about Final Fantasy VI, and I forget who's from where, and I just... Someone comes over. So, Dre, did you come over from... Chat and Go? Okay, you're on Chat and Go. There you go. Yeah, Sam, you said he was gonna hop over, but guess not. Or maybe he doesn't have a screen name, I don't know. Or maybe he's lagging out, 'cause I know he's not in the country, so maybe he's got a bad connection. I don't know. So yeah. Aw, lost your Twitch account. Gotcha. Gotcha. Well, for there you are. Get your priorities straight. Actually, U plus probably is. So, good, good. I'm glad it's running better. Incidentally, there's more delay, and I'm wondering if that's giving your ISP more time to do everything. We got a lot of people on tonight, which is really cool. So, for those of you who this is your first time showing up, oh, I do Final Fantasy VI hacking. And we've been working on enhancing the desperation attack system for quite a few weeks, and we took a few weeks off. And actually, last week I went over some stuff from my personal hack called Children of Vector. And so this, what we're looking at right here, is actually some of my code changes that I made in the hex, because I actually go into the game and I make changes in the actual machine code. And that sounds really boring, and kind of is, unless you're into this kind of thing, in which case it's super awesome, because you can do really cool stuff with it. So, just real quick to show you guys what it is I'm talking about. Oh, wait, actually, you know what? I don't want to run Desperation. I want to run Children of Vector. And let me know if my sound's off. I ask every single week. Good, man, I'm glad this is running smoothly. Oh no, I don't think I have a save ready. So these are some people from my personal hack. I brought Wedge and Vix back, and that's a unique character, L'Oreal, or an original character, L'Oreal, and I wrote her a unique ability that works totally different. What this does, and ignore Vargas, he's got issues. He's got issues. I can skip this. I can skip this. And so she's got a special ability that I came up with that basically bases off the characters in the party. So L'Oreal would be considered the Oracle, Vargas, martial artist, and Wedge and Vix are both marked as Imperial Soldier. And based on that, it's got its own basically custom rage code that has a bunch of different things. So she just casts Shell, and I actually need to fix that so that I can cast on everybody, not. Becomes a shell gub, basically. And so it's basically a new kind of rage that has some AI built into it so that it's not totally useless, and power scaling so that the nothing becomes obsolete. And so you'll see that she just kind of does her own thing. And so this has got a whole unique story or whatever else, and that's neither here nor there. If you guys stick around, you'll learn all about my hack at some point. So the first thing I was basically showing off today was actually going to be some of the code changes that we did. And, or that I did, rather. Did I say we? I meant I. So that we can kind of branch off into what it takes to edit attacks in the middle of the code. So all of the attacks in the game have all of their data preset. And so when it loads up the attack, it loads all these variables that go into the RAM and tell the attack what kind of properties it has. And there's a number of things that I did here and that we're going to end up doing with the desperation hack, where we're basically going to edit those in the middle of the damage calculations code so that we can have a specific effect happen at a specific time under a specific circumstance. So it's a lot of extra work and coding, but it helps you to segregate things and diversify what you're doing. So, for instance, with the trances, this portion of the code here basically loads up the trances and sets up the menu. menu display, codes for the characters, finger positioning. Man, this took a long time to go through and figure out. Where is my damage? Actually, you know what? I think that might be in a different... That might be in a different thing. Damage calc. Should be trance damage calcs. Okay, never mind. This is just where I worked out the math for it. This is just where I worked out the math for it. I do have it in here. Yeah, trance. What is this? This is where it's actually performing the code. So after you've selected it, it pulls the number for the character that you selected, basically. It increases it by one. And then does a bunch of other things. Find out if it's an empty slot. Figure out which character it corresponds to. I wrote this, like, 3 years ago, so I'm a little bit rusty. The enemies fixed Vargas. Wait, what are you talking about? Did I miss something? Did Vargas, like, all of a sudden start working? That's not true. Or did they give him a status and it made him look more or less normal? I'll have to go back and look at that. Anyway, so this is basically just all the logic. What I was going to look for is the damage stuff. Where is that? Where is that? This looks like damaged things. Oh, he turned into a weakened. Yeah, because I didn't finish that sprite sheet. And so when he went to the crouching pose, that was Shadow. Okay, was this the old code or was this? Uh-oh. Okay. This is the code where it's actually... I think this was the old code. Damage and targeting modifiers. Hey, there we go. Alright, so this is in the code in the C2 bank where all that stuff is happening. And so when it's working out the damage, I should have... JSR somewhere in here that I put in. This right here, I believe. So we're jumping to 6526, which push A, push P, which you have to do at the beginning of a lot of stuff. For anyone that's gonna get into hacking on this level, you're gonna want to push. You're gonna want to get in the habit of pushing whatever variables you're working with, so that when you're done, you can pull them again. And so basically, the code's running the way that the game set it up. And when you're done, it needs to be back where it started so that the game doesn't blow up, basically. Because it's in the middle of working with numbers, and if you're altering things, you need to make sure it's got the right numbers when it's done with your portion of the code. So if you're doing something isolated, you have to make sure when you push a variable, whether it's A, whether it's processor status, whether it's X, Y, whatever. When you push it, it's basically going into like a little tunnel, and it's like adding Legos to a stack, and then they come off in basically the reverse order. You have to take them back off one at a time while you go down. So when you're pushing all these things, you put them all in there, and then you can change your variables, do what you're going to do, but as soon as you're done with your code, you got to pull those all back out again so you don't blow stuff up. So you're going to see a lot of that in my code. This is some more advanced stuff, setting up the processor. I believe, I can't remember whether that's setting the processor to, or the accumulator to 8-bit or 16-bit or whatever, but it's something like that. Basically lengthening or shortening our accumulator, which is our basic variable that's working inside the processor. When you're doing calculations, there's a variable that's constantly changing. That's the accumulator. That's what we call it. decumulator, or A. And so when we set the processor bits, that's basically, and I'll give you another visual for this too, that's basically setting these up here. I think it's these. So three, I'm not sure which direction these go actually, so I don't really remember. It might be the overflow, it might be, see, set processor. So it's going to set two things. So it's not going to be zero. So it's probably these two. I don't know. I know this is impressive, isn't it? I say I don't know to like three quarters of the stuff I'm talking about. That's right. We'll get it all down eventually. 8-bit X, Y, and A. Thank you, Mad. Yeah, which ones are they? It is this right here that it's setting up though, right? 10 is X and Y, then that must be index. And memory. Okay, yes, because memory is whether you're using A or A and B, because B is basically. Okay, that's from like a memorization standpoint, Mad. So yes, and that's how I learned it originally, but I have a terrible memory. I have to know why things work. And so when I looked at it, it's setting up this byte right here. You know, each of these is a bit. And so this is a byte. So set processor is turning it on. Reset, I think, turns it off. I'll have to go back and look. I can do that actually. In fact, let's go to the opcodes. There's a reason I have all these links in here so that we can actually look up stuff, because this is actually what I do when I'm hacking. These down here. The setups of processor flags with opcode argument for each corresponding flag is set or reset. Yeah, okay. Yeah, it just turns it, it's basically on off. Yeah, 0, 1 is carry, which is this, which means 1, 0 is index. So yeah, index is whether the X and Y registers are 8-bit or 16-bit, and memory must be the accumulator for 8-bit and 8-bit and 16-bit. Right? Carry flag, 0 flag. IRQ flag, which I don't know what that does. Yep, X and Y register accumulate. Okay, yep. So when it's on, which is memory, that's when, so there's also a secondary accumulator, basically, and that's what they've got this memory flag for. And basically, it takes that 16 bits and it cuts it into two 8-bit registers, which we call A and B. And you can actually flip them at basically any time. You generally don't work directly with B. You basically work with A, and then you switch A and B, and you can do some work with B and switch them back or whatever else. All right. So all that to say, that's what's going on here. And then it loads something else up. I should have gone over this code a little bit ahead of time. I forget how complicated some of this stuff is. So this is where we're getting into the damage modifiers. Basically, it's loading the character's level, comparing it to 50. 32 is 50 in hex, in hexadecimal. So the damage modifier caps off at level 50. Oh, which I say right here in my comments. And then stores that in temporary variable. And then basically it's going to check for what kind of spell it is, because that's going to affect what damage modifier I want to do with it. Yeah, XBA is transfer X and, or I mean A and B. And that's why I had this. So what I ended up doing, I really need to work on my pronunciation. Enunciate. I can do that. I really can. All right. So twice the level plus spell power divided by 4 is regular spell power. And so what I did was I did some basic calculations with low-level spells and high-level spells to see how it scaled. So for fire, whose spell power is 20, which is really low, and for marker, fire 3, or firaga, depending on your translation, has a spell power of 110? I can check that also. There's always things to check. Being smart, and I've said this before, being smart has almost nothing to do with knowing everything, but has everything to do with knowing where to get the answers. All right, so spell fire 3. Okay, it has a spell power of 121. Wow, that's pretty big. All right, and so you can see at level 10, it's already slightly stronger than fire is. There's I mean, I'll admit there's a lot to keep track of, but again, that's why I introduced the flowcharts, which is what I'm going to do tonight if I start working on, if I get working on damage modifiers for the desperation attacks, or damage and setup. Anyway, I'll start working with that flowchart, and I'll put all that in place before we actually do any coding. You lost the chat. There's really not a whole lot happening in chat. Anyway. So you can see how fire scales as she hits level 20, 30, 40, and 50. And that stays pretty consistent. Clearly, fire doesn't do as much damage as fire 3 does. But she also does things like cast Pearl, in which case it ends out stronger. 108 versus 127. And she has a chance to cast Pearl starting at level 1, which scales back to 47, which is still extremely powerful for level 1, but not, like, OP. Alright, ignore defense spells, you definitely have to have a different setup, because they can very quickly become overpowered. They can very, very quickly become overpowered. But in the same way, you can see how it scales, and it works pretty nicely. And I tested all these to make sure that she was properly powered when casting these kinds of spells. Ultima gets kind of up there, which, incidentally, I took Ultima out of Children of Vector, but at level 50, instead of a power of 150, has a power of 216, also ignoring defense. That's right, we don't actually have to worry about that, because I took Ultima out. And the healing. But basically, I did exactly this in the code. So, spell power divided by 2, which you can do very easy with a bit shift. If you take all the bits and you shift them to... What's it going to be for you? Hold on. Take all the bits and you shift them to the left. No, wait, to the right. Yeah. Shift them to the right. Basically, all your bits shift down, and that's cutting the number in half. Easy ways to do math. Easy ways to do math in hex when you're working with because you don't have any opcodes that are multiplication and division. You have to kind of figure that out on your own. Yeah, but Ultima spam is a little too OP. It's too easy. It's too centralizing. You do not want over centralization of gameplay. All right. So say we have 10110. All right. So what's that in decimal? That's 22. So I shift all of these bits to the right, and that becomes 1011. And turns out that's 11, half of 22. All right. So easy way to cut a number in half if you're doing this here, if you're doing any kind of programming, is do a bit shift to the right. Bit shift to the right. Divides by 2. And then all you do is you and then I added the level and so on and so forth. And that is basically this formula right here. And then you've got your new number, and you store that back into the spell power. So you've got the spell power that the game automatically loaded. We pull it out, we load it into A, we do all of our modifications, and we stick it back where it came from. So you just plunk it out, fiddle with it, stick it back in. Really that simple. That's all any of this is. It's just a matter of figuring out where it's called and where you can do it. But it's really, really not that difficult. So let's see where I did it for trance. Where is trance? I was already in trance. So where was this called from? (2966). Let's look at that in the C2 disassembly. 2966. What am I doing? Find. There we go. C2. 2966. Load spell data. Wouldn't you know it? Load spell data. This is when it's setting up. Actually, this might be specifically for rages. I don't remember. Is this the rage code? Or is this the damage? I think this is actually damage. This is initialization. No, Okay, I think this actually is where it's getting ready to set up for an attack. So there's actually a couple places you could put it. When you do a modification, all you need to do is make sure you do it after it's been set up, after it's been called, and before it pulls it out to do damage. So, hypothetically, we're looking for the... Let's see. Where is the spell power in here? Spell power is not in there. Spell power is not in there. What was it? Spell power is... Hold on. I was just there. So, 11A6. So, just for fun, let's find out what we get when we look up 11A6. And specifically, and there you see it, battle power. You see where it's starting to get, where this stuff gets used. What loads for what? Are you talking about 14 bytes all at once? Like the, what is it called? That's the memory thing, right? Oh, yeah, this right here. Yes. That's where it's calling it right there. And the game will break. If you set a breakpoint, you guys like it. I feel like the stream is more interesting when I spend more time doing stuff like this. So I'm going to set a breakpoint for right. Well, actually, I'm not going to do that just yet. I'm not going to do that just yet. So let's run that. And let me get up. And so you can set breakpoints to help find this code rather than doing a really boring search in here. Although this might technically be better in most cases. Oh, that's right, because I got that. Yep. Alright, so let's get into a battle, and I'm going to set up a breakpoint on... There we go. Alright, so we're going to set it up at the damage or the battle power. So 7E is our memory bank, and then 11A6 is where it's at. And we'll be able to see every time that that pops up. Alright, so look, C2297A, right here. This right here is basically a block copy. It's a block copy. And so it copies 14 spell bytes into RAM. And I believe, I'm trying to remember exactly how the syntax works for that. How it knows what to copy where. Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And I used to miss these a lot. Before I knew that this existed, I used to miss these a lot when I was looking for... There I go again. When I was looking for variables in the code. So this copies a block of code from C4, 6A plus 6AXX. Right, so where does that come from? I used to understand this. See, this is why I keep you around, Mad. Keep me in line. Keep me in line. Where does it get that? From C4... Is it from C427E? That would be a lot more than 14 bytes. Move a block of bytes from a specified data or specified address to another address. The X register will be the start address. Ah, okay. There you go. The X register will be the start address to copy from. The Y register will be the start address to copy to. The C register will be the number of bytes to copy minus 1. The opcode arguments are the source bank and the destination bank in this order. So that means that we're copying from the C4 bank to the 7E bank. And then we can't see this here, but we can see this here. So this is one of the times where this is handy, is that we can see X and Y are set up for the locations. So we're pulling from C477CA. And we're copying to 7E11A6. All right, does that make sense? That's right. And then the load A there is how many bytes? So the accumulator is how many bytes to copy. So D works out to 14. So if you ever need to move a bunch of stuff from one place to another, this is an easier way to do it than trying to do it one at a time. All right, we need to get a little bit of focus here. I feel like we've kind of been meandering. I've kind of been going down stuff, but it hasn't been super coherent. So let's get to an actual thing. MVN or MVP. Wow. All right, let's get to an actual thing. Because I'm boring myself. So, for the sake of my own entertainment, I'm going to find something else to do now. Alright, Trance, you're gone. This is... So there's another place you can set up an edit abilities. And... This is another thing that gets loaded first time around. That's these over here. These over here are basically custom code that do things outside of what you can do with the regular modification bytes, damage type targeting, statuses, etc. This is all the special stuff. And changing these is kind of fun. And so I actually had an example of that. Wish, which is, and I don't have Children of Vector loaded, which is Wedge's first guts, uses this right here. I placed it over top of the mantra code. And it does some special stuff. So the first thing it does is to set it so that it doesn't split damage or ignore, or yeah, and ignores defense. So that means I'm working with true damage, because it's actually healing and damage, I guess, because it's entirely based off of his HP. So the first thing you have to do is make sure that nothing's getting changed. Set not to modify damage. I don't remember exactly what that is. Oh, store zero. That means we're clearing a byte. Probably something. I think that's... Oh, that's does not modify damage. I think that's like when you've got like a party member. It's supposed to cut the damage in half. Stuff like that. And then it loads up Wedge's attack. Oh, no, I'm sorry. This is the targeting. I'm sorry. Loads up the targeting. And then make sure, finds out which character is you, maybe? I don't remember exactly. But anyway, this makes it, takes Wedge out as the target. And then sets the total number of targets. And I believe, yeah, see, this was, I believe this was an empty variable that I used for a lot of different stuff temporarily. And I kept the number of targets in there because it modifies how much damage or how much healing is done to each character. Okay, so this is where we're getting into like really specific stuff. But all this stuff can be set up in one spot, which is a really nice bonus of these pieces of code right here. Because they let you break this stuff and do other things. And then there's also a damage modifier. And that basically makes sure that we don't... yeah, exactly. It's a straight damage modifier because it's not based off of spell power. I actually have it based off of his health. So in the damage code, I had it jump out to the damage modifier. And then just as a reference... This is actually right next to my 32,000 damage cap function in Children of Vector. Because in Children of Vector, some attacks are going to be able to break the 9999 damage cap. But only some attacks, not all of them. Anyway. So I put that in the code right before that. And all it does is it takes his health and... Excuse me. And then it basically takes a certain percentage of it based on... So I think it will take a third of your health. It'll take a third of your health if you are... Yeah, I think it's a third of your health if there's only one other party member. A quarter of your health if there's two other party members, and a fifth of your health if there's three other party members, and then multiplies it, triples the healing, and then it's set as like an absorb. Only it works in reverse, obviously. So it heals them and hurts Wedge for the same amount. No, they're not. There's actually two lists. If you look in the code, it would have been nice if all these were empty. I mean, I think a lot of them are. And incidentally, I may have overwritten a couple things that are actually things. I just don't remember. So let's go look at that. Let's go look at that. That's a really good question, Locke. So this is in C2. And I think special is the word. Special effect. Wait. It's a table. I can't remember what it's called. Let's try effect, actually. I don't know. It's right next to a... There should be a big table for it. Hold on. I actually do have this. Actually... No. Although, come to think of it, I should have in my documentation somewhere where it tells me where I saved it. Right? I should have the modification I made in the... Yeah, right here. All right, so this is one of it. Table for special effects code pointers 1. And then there's a number 2, and they kind of, like, are... offset from each other. They're basically offset from each other. So let me find this. C2, and then it's just copy. Find the bam. Yes, those are all the places it comes from. Alright, so pointer 1. And you see that these are blank here. And then it does some other stuff. And I can't remember if I worked out the rhyme or reason for this, so let's find out together. But you'll see when we look at this, these are all blank. These 8C38, that's just jumping to an RTS, if I remember correctly. And you'll see that those are the ones that actually have things in here. Right? Blank, blank, blank. 3, 4, right? 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. 0, 1, 2. Okay, maybe they don't all line up. I thought it lined up to an extent. So let me find pointers 2. So that's just a normal attack, which should jump to a return anyway. Does this one line up better? Dagnabbit. I'm tired of that getting in my way. There. There we go. This is going to make this easier. So nothing. Try to steal item. That doesn't have anything here, so maybe that's a different thing. All right, neither of these actually look like they line up exactly. Can I open a second copy of this? Nah, well. I could, but it's more effort than it's worth. Yeah. Incidentally, a lot of them are... blanks. Let's go look at a few of them. So this is taking us to 4044. They're in Endian order, so they're like that. So 4044. Do 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 do. 4044. So this is Atma weapon. Oh, okay. Some of them are used for like weapon effects. If that's actually what this is, then I'm assuming that that's what's going on here. Warpstone effect. So let's find out if that's one. Let's go back down. In fact, if I do 4E 4O, yep, warpstone effect right here. So it could be that some are like weapons and items, and then the other ones is abilities. The last F entries would be, I'm assuming that's in hex, and so that would be the last 15 entries for item spell effects. There's a lot more than 30 of these in here. So I don't know about that. The last, no, because I mean steel isn't, oh, what do we have? Try to steal item, randomly kill, doesn't work on zombies, so that would be doom darts. Random select graphic animation. Yeah, I guess I can see all those being item type things. And then all these, I mean, don't get used for the most part, down to like here. And then here's abilities. And then down at the bottom, I don't see anything. I mean, those all look blank right there. What if those are blank on the other one? Let's go to pointers one. You blank on the bottom too? Nope, at the bottom you have things. So what do we have here? Let's find 39 399E. So 399E. Steal function. Steal function. Oops, 39. Yeah, so for the most part, they're just offset. There might be a handful that have nothing in either one, like this one right here, entry two. So if I go to pointers two, oh no, that has one. That has one. So actually, incidentally, when I made my mist breath attack for my mist dragon summon, actually overwrote the, well, you know what? It calls two different sets of pointers. If it's two different sets of pointers, then there's, I don't know if we maybe can just segregate them. I mean, that's a, let's find out when it calls this and if the other one is in there also. So C2. So 42E1 is pointers 2. And 42E1. 42E1, 42E1. I'm gonna put that over here. 42E1. And 3DCD. Those are the two places our pointer tables are at. And so let's look and see where we find those. So let's do 42E1. So that calls it and is independent. Okay. Call special effect code. So yeah, this is the, so that's where that's called, and the this I don't even know. So these might actually be segregated. These might be segregated, which would mean that yes, you can use them as long as you're using them in the right place for the right items. So let's look up the other one real quick. Let's look up the other one. 3DCD, right? 3DCD. And so call special effect code 3DCD. What? I did not do that. 3DCD, come on. And then all the other things. Yeah, so they're both only called once. It appears that they're both only called once. That's not, it's almost never necessarily the case. So let's find out if it runs both of these during an attack. That's a good way to test this. So tonight's kind of turning into a what's this process look like kind of deal. I don't feel like we're really hitting anything specific because we're already at 10:20 right now. And even if it's a little bit unfocused, this is research. This is research. So let's set up two breakpoints. Let's set up a breakpoint at, I need to load the game first. All right. And let's set up a breakpoint at C23886. And then our other one here. Oops, not that. In fact, I'm going to close that. And then our other one at, oops. Did I close? There we go. All right, C23E85. Okay. Did I do that right? 3E85, yes. Okay, so now I'm really interested to see, because hypothetically that would open up a ton of space based on what it is you're doing. Since we have a million of everything, this would be a good character to do it on. So this is actually important research for whatever we do, whether I do more with Children of Vector or whether we decide to jump into the code with the desperation attacks. This is information we're going to want to have. All right, so first of all, let's what's something that runs a special code? What's something that runs a scan? Scan runs a special code. All right, so we stopped, and we're at the this one right here, 42E1, which is special effect code 2 or something. Oh, that called the other one too. I hit run, and you can see right here, and I hope this is visible to you guys. Can you guys see this part right here? I might have to try to find a way to increase its size, but can you guys see this, the disassembly I've got when I'm breaking the code? If you can, I'll have to describe it for you. But anyway, it did stop at both of those places. So it runs for both pointers. Now hypothetically, now there may be, it's possible that there's a chance to run both of those things at once. Like, in what situation would you need both of those? There's got to be either a spell that uses two different things, or maybe, like, a weapon cast on an attack or something. You know, that might be it. Did it run the item one first, or did it run, or the one that appears to be more for items, or the one that the 42E1. 42E1. Yes, this is the item one. Because the items may pick a spell. So it runs them in that order for a reason. Okay, all right. This is what we got. This is what we got. It's using this special code to find out what's going on, like if we run Super Ball, and that's a good idea. We'll do that. Well, you'll see the chat in the video, right? You just can't type into it, and it'll be delayed. But anyway. So I think what's happening here, and let's, just as an exercise here, let's go ahead. And see if I can make a diagram thing out of this. Create a new diagram, blank diagram. Okay, so what we're looking at here is basically, I think circle is start. Yay. All right, so we're starting, and the player picks an ability. Start. And the first thing that it's going to do is it's going to check for the item special code. Because it needs to find out if it's got to pick something, basically. It's got to figure out, one, if the item itself has a special effect, like it would on an attack. And then two, for things like, well, not. I'm using online Visio, basically. Online. I have Visio on here, but I'm using online Visio because this is something that everyone can use. And I call it online Visio, even though it's just draw.io. Draw.io. You can go here. So basically, it's going in here, and what just happened to my screen? What just happened to my screen? Huh. Well, I just blew up my internet browser somehow. Thanks, Firefox. Well, and I won't be able to kill that just that window, will I? Can you all still see me? Whatever's going on? My screen is jacked up right now. My screen is jacked up. I'm going to try to just close this one. No, both of them died. Both of them died. So I'm not going to be able to see Twitch for a moment. But I'll get back on there. Let me kill this. Hey, it's trying to fix things. Go away, flowchart maker. You've hurt me for the last time. Let's at least look and see what's going on here. Wow. Wow. I apologize. OBS looks like it's still working, so. But it is taking its sweet time getting back up to Twitch on my browser. Let's get rid of that. I need a new computer. Or a computer that's actually mine. Maybe that would be the better way to say that. Slowly getting stuff. This is extremely jacked up. I need this to load properly with chat. Super interesting. All right. Let's see what I missed in chat here. I can barely see my screen on OBS, so give me just a second. All right, well, glad everything kept working, because I also just realized that I never started recording. So we're gonna be using the Twitch backup today. I'll have to chop it, but we'll be able to use the Twitch backup to put on YouTube. All right, I am back in chat. I don't know if I want to bring up that thing again. I mean, that's the first time I've had that problem, but my computer's been acting up a lot today. So I don't know if I want to continue doing that. But let me just explain it without picture things. I think the reason why it loads at both times, because you can do anything you want in either one of those. I think the reason it runs both times is so that it has a chance to, if you either use a rod or you use something like the Super Ball, which is going to call another attack, like an ability, that second time it needs to, that's why the abilities need to be in that second one. The abilities need to be in that second one because they've already run that special code, and now it's saying, okay, now what are we actually doing? Now what are we running? So I think that's why that. So hypothetically, if we wanted to change abilities specifically, we could change it in the ability side of the pointer list, which is not this one, which is pointers one. This one right here is for abilities. And you can hypothetically change things in here for abilities. So in one of those tables, there's a return, and in the other, there's active code. I'm not sure what you mean by that. Both of them are tables, and they're the same length, and they call different sets of code. So each one of these is a jump to code. And then all these ones that you see that are exactly the same just jump to return to sender. And so those are basically blank. And this one, code pointers 1, which should probably actually be code pointers 2, is where all of the abilities and spells have their special code set up and run. The other one here, this is where items take place, and many, maybe other things that might choose a spell, and I can't think of anything off the top of my head that does that outside of very specific code like Rage, but that wouldn't take place here. That takes place, that's all straight up coded into the ability. And this has its own jump to a return to sender. Okay. The reason, I'm trying to think of specifically why there would be a reason to line up these two tables the same way. Because, well, I mean, why not just segregate them entirely? and have them just be two totally separate tables that would get run. And I guess that would make it two different bytes that would have to be set instead of one. I guess maybe they're trying to minimize how many bytes they have to set on weapons and abilities. Because if you think about it, they have to have a byte for the special effect for every single ability and every single item and weapon. So every single one of those has to have access to this. Actually, that makes me think. If I go to the items, hypothetically, there should be something somewhere. That's this here, maybe? No. That's the animation thing. Extra effects, ha! Hold on. Atma weapon, O2. Atma weapon. See, but if there's no overlap, why not just make two separate tables? If there's literally no overlap, unless there's an ability that calls one of these, unless there's literally like a regular ability that calls one of these, like drain HP, drain MP, like drain. I wonder if that. So let's go back to what I'm trying to figure out is if there's any reason why both of those would exist. So let's go to spell. Let's go to drain. And no, it's drain set for nothing because it's just got this right here. You know what? I don't know why they did that. There might be a reason, and it might be worth looking into at some point. And another noticeable gap is that in the items menu, it really only had space for the first 16 spaces, 0 through F. So the first 16 spaces, that's the only space it had for an ability effect. But I believe the table has some more of these, so there must be some other things that call this. There must be some other things that call this. I'm not sure what. I'm not sure what exactly. Hypothetically, every action in battle is going to go through the code. But for all intents and purposes, let's see if there's any. Let's see if there are any of these that would need to not be altered. So hypothetically, if you had an item that uses something, so like with Atma weapon, with the Atma weapon damage. So I told you that my Mist Dragon's attack, I set up the code, and it has the same spot as the Atma weapon attack. Now I had stuck it up in pointers 1. But what would happen would be when Atma weapon attacked, first it would go through, the first thing it would do would be go through its code, because that's the set that ran first. First it would run through its code right here. But then, as it moves on, it would get to my custom code, and the Atma weapon would get overwritten by my Mist Dragon damage setup. So yes, I broke the Atma weapon in Children of Vector. I found a bug without even actually playing any of the game. Ta-da! Once per target, once per strike. I can see why that might be a thing. I can see why that might be a thing. Where am I at? What is that from? Is that from the new C2 stuff? I might have an old thing. Incidentally, I never re-downloaded anything because I had made a bunch of notes on my C2 disassembly. So where are you getting that from? Yes, I'm waiting for an answer. So if I go. Yeah, someone please let me know what the definitive version for all this stuff is. Where's documentation? I could have swore we had something for the documentation in here. I'm sure it is a more recent disassembly. I've got to get them all together and put them together for my purposes. Don't want to be looking all over the place. I don't remember where that was. Was that in hacking discussion? Or was that up here? Let me see what it looks like in here. You guys probably can't read that, but I'm gonna go to the same place in the code. 3DCD. Really? 3DCD doesn't exist? C2 slash 3D. How? How is there no 3? Okay, apparently he did not disassemble the whole thing. I don't know. What's going on here? Yeah, it starts at 6.8. It must just be in chunks. It must just not be the whole thing. Well, that's not helpful. That's not helpful. Right, well, there must be another document. I'm gonna have to get all that stuff together and shove it together. Incidentally, Notepad++ can do comparisons, so I can get them side by side. And copy a bunch of changes over. Anyway, so it's running both of these. Once per strike and once per target, huh? That would mean this would probably likely be once per strike or once per target, and this would be once per strike, maybe? Or maybe the other way around, because then it would run the, I don't know. But I know a way I can check that. And I'm not entirely sure if this will do this, if this will do the attack. Oh, who's running this right now? All right, so we just got another break. And I don't know if this is their attack or my attack, so we'll just find out. Oh, yep, that was their escape. Alright, so now we stopped again. This time I believe we're on Cyan, who I just charged Quadra Slam on. So, 3DCD. And it runs it every time. It runs both of them every single strike, at least for Quadra Slam. So it definitely ran both of them. Huh. Wiki links assassin website. Okay. Right, well, the only other thing I can think of off the top of my head that's multiple hits is launcher. Unless I'm forgetting something. Somebody correct me if I'm wrong, but other than And like things like offering, which could instantly have multiple strikes. Yeah, I might have to tinker around with this, but it looks like both are used. And so yeah, you really can't without doing some changes, you really can't replace anything unless you can find one that is blank in both spaces. Because either way, you're going to screw something up. If it's an item, you're screwing it up. If it's you're using the same offset in the other one. So yeah, so this might be something for us to do. We might need to separate these. We might need to separate these. So I wonder if there's anything that has two different. What I would like to do is get this side by side with the other one. Can I open just another copy of my C2 assembly? Yeah, I want to open another copy of it. C2 assembly 2. Right, so now I've got C2 disassembly 2 and C2 disassembly. Can I just pull actually let's do a compare. I don't remember how to do a compare. Compare. Don't crash. Oh man. It is nothing but technical difficulties tonight. Look, I get that these are really large text files. Maybe this was not the best idea. Maybe it wasn't the best idea. Oh man. Own an exception. Oh geez, that's what you were comparing? Right, I just want C2 disassembly 2 to pop up. Please don't run the whole thing again. Okay. All right. So this one's got. Let me go over here and I'll just find pointers too. Oh, don't take me both of them. I don't want them both to be there. I want to separate them. Don't do this to me. All right, let's just uncompare. Let's. Nope. Fraser resin. Okay. All right. Well, that's not really that important. I'm ready to ditch that now that we've used the entire night. Thank you. I swear, I'm learning more from you guys tonight. Would you say duplicate? Want to duplicate a tab? Right click, clone to other view. Thank you. Okay. So this one, I want to find pointers one. This one over here. Ah, shoot, it's still scrolling them together. Pain in the butt. Hold on, I don't think I'm on this. It's changing them both times whenever I change something. It changes both of them. Just want to drag one of them. So I'm gonna just like use my fingers and do different things with them. No. Ah. Well, it may have been because I already ran the compare plugin, and I probably can't just, like, turn it off. Maybe it's because they are so similar. Man, I don't even know. Let's close this. Let's, maybe if I relaunch it. So let's grab something similar. How about move to other view instead of clone to other view? I bet that'll do it. Haha. Okay. All right, pointers one, pointers two. Wow, that took way more time than it should have. All right, if I can make this one bigger, I can. So that they're about the same size. And then we should be able to just go across here and see. Like, both of those look like they're just returns. That's Atma weapon. And that, and then look, 5, 6, and 7. So 13. This here has code in both places. And it's different. And instead of changing where I'm at here, I'm actually gonna load it up and see what uses both those things. Let's see what uses both of those things. Spell 8B9. Oh wait, sorry, we're doing in hex 1-3, isn't it? So 0, 1, 2, 3. Palador. Palador does it. Stupid Palador. Okay. And then those are both returns. The next one after that are both returns. Even if in... Oh, nope. That actually does have nothing. So we found one blank space. 15, 16, and then 17 over here. 18 up, 19 is another one that, 19 is another one, so 14, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, exploder, exploders and has code in both. All right, so now these are lined up again. 1C. So there's a couple things that actually have one in both. Okay, here's another one that's blank, so we're at 2. A few more that have one in both. All right, let's line up. 36 should go there. Okay, yes, I am lined up. So every once in a while, we've got a handful that are unused. That's the crux of this. All right. Oh, here's four in a row that are unused on both sides. So it looks like you can. And somebody correct me if I'm wrong, but this, no. Oh, shoot. I may have been off center here. Hold on. Three, two, 51, 50. Hold on. I may have had that wrong. No, there's still a few. There's still a few. So it looks like there's a handful. Maybe I wasn't counting, but maybe eight. Where you can put in special effects, and then everything else you're gonna have to do is like an edit or an expansion of the table, which isn't that hard. Or we could segregate these and have the ones that need both call both. So yeah. Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised if I caught Kuka's curse. Anyway. So I think that's where I'm gonna cut it off for the night. I know we didn't really do a whole lot today. We ended up spending a lot of time just kind of looking at things and how it worked, which is incidentally helpful for me. Especially if I want to keep doing stuff, and I do. I really do. So, next week, actually, I'm not going to be able to stream. I've got a couple things coming up, and so I'm going to be actually busy next week, and I will not have time to stream. But 2 weeks from now, we will be back on, and I will hit the ground running. I'll have something in place, and we'll hit the ground running so that we don't spend the whole night kind of tinkering around, not getting a whole lot of things done. All right, that is all I've got for tonight. Thank you guys for logging in. I will be in the chat for a few minutes. I've got to get this video downloaded, but I hope you guys enjoyed the stream and hopefully learned something. I know I picked up a few things myself, and we will see you guys next time. All right, have a good one. Happy hacking.